Hello everyone, welcome back. Topic is vertical jaw relation. So I've already covered about the orientation jaw relation and how you are going to orient the occlusal rim. So first we make a alat regis line. We mark a point that is the alat regis line and then we orient our occlusal rim according to it. Then we are doing the orientation jaw relation and the next one is the vertical jaw relation. Now what is the definition of vertical jaw relation? So the length of the face as determined by the amount of the separation of the jaw is nothing but the vertical jaw relation, and it is given by glossary of prosthodontic term. So the length of the face which is determined by the amount of the separation of the jaws. So the amount of separation of the jaws, that is the amount of separation of the maxillary and the mandibular jaw. So depending upon that, the length of the face, it is determined. So it can also be defined as it is the amount of separation between the maxilla and the mandible in the frontal plane. So if this record, it is not measured accurately, the joint will be overstrained. That is your TMJ, it will be overstrained. That can be overextended or it can be underextended. The separation, it depends. So the separation between the maxilla and the mandible, it depends upon the TMJ and the tones of muscles of mastication. So if the vertical dimension, it is altered, there will be severe discomfort in both the TMJ and the muscles of mastication. As your separation, it is dependent upon these two factors. And if your vertical dimension is not taken properly, if it is not measured properly, then there will be severe discomfort to the patient. This relation is basically the easiest to record, but it is very critical. Because the vertical dimension are the first to produce discomfort and strain to the patient. So it can be recorded in two positions, that is vertical dimension at rest and vertical dimension at occlusion. So over here, as you can see, this is the vertical dimension at rest. So see the position of the, so see how the patient look when the vertical dimension is at rest and if it is at occlusion. So you'll see there is this strain which is produced. Now what are the effects of the altered vertical dimensions? So these can be like if there is increased vertical dimension or if there is decreased vertical dimension. Now your increased vertical dimension, it can lead to trauma to the denture bearing area, and if it is decreased, there is comparatively less trauma. If it is increased, so if the vertical dimension is increased, there is increase in the lower facial height. So as we have seen earlier that the definition was the vertical dimension is nothing but the length of the face is determined by that. So if the vertical dimension is increased, then it will increase the height. If it is decreased, then it is decreasing the height. If it is increased, then there is cheek biting. And if it is decreased, there is angular chelitis. There is difficulty in swallowing and speech in increased vertical dimension. If the vertical dimension it is decreased, there is only difficulty in swallowing. There is pain and clicking in the TMJ. And there is stretching of the facial muscle. As we have seen, the factors which are dependent on the separation are these TMJ and the muscles of mastication. So in this case, you'll see there is pain over TMJ and there can be stretching of the facial muscle. Over here, you'll see there is pain, clicking and discomfort to the TMJ, which is accompanied with headache. There is loss of lip fullness. Then there is obstruction to the opening of the eustachian tube due to the elevation of the soft palate. Then there is loss of muscle tone. The corners of the mouth, they are turned downwards. Then there is thinning of the vermilion border of the lip. So these all are the effects of the decreased vertical dimension. Then over here there is increased volume and over here there is decreased volume, or it is the cubical space of the oral cavity. Now what are the factors which affect the vertical jaw relation? So these are the teeth and the musculature. Now first we are going to start with the vertical dimension at rest. So vertical dimension at rest, it is defined as it is the length of the face when the mandible is in the rest position. So the length of the face when your mandible is in the rest position is nothing but the vertical dimension at rest. So this is the position of the mandible in relation to the maxilla when the maxillofacial musculature, they are in state of tonic equilibrium. So this is nothing but the position of the mandible in relation to the maxilla when they are in equilibrium. So this position, it is influenced by muscles of mastication, muscles which are involved in speech, deglutition and breathing. It acts as a reference point during recording the vertical dimension at rest, at occlusion. So it acts as a reference point. So first you take the dimension, vertical dimension at rest, and this dimension at rest, it acts as a reference point when you're taking the vertical dimension and occlusion. Now, what is this vertical dimension at rest? So basically, vertical dimension at rest, it has this formula, that is vertical dimension at occlusion plus the freeway space. So now, what is this freeway space? So freeway space is the space which is present when your mandible, when the mandible is at rest, there is a space which is present between the teeth. So basically, your teeth, they are not occluded when it is rest, and that is nothing but the freeway space. And freeway space is usually 2 to 4 mm, which is present, and it should be recorded at the physiological rest position of the mandible. So the vertical dimension, it should be recorded at the physiological. So if there are patients with prolonged edentulousness, the mandible, it shifts to a habitual rest position, and the complete denture, it should not be fabricated using this habitual rest position. And hence, the physiological rest position, it should be determined in the patient before recording the vertical jaw relations. Now, what are the considerations? So the physical rest position, it is influenced by a number of factors. So first is the position of the mandible, it is influenced by the gravity and the posture of the head. So hence, while recording the vertical jaw relation, the patient, he should be asked to sit upright with his head upright and the eyes, they are looking straight in front. So the reed baseline, it should be parallel to the floor. So this is the reed baseline, it should be parallel to the floor. This is the first consideration. The next is the all the muscles which are affecting, it should be relaxed. So the patient, he should not be stressed or strained. In that, the signs like tension, strain, nervousness, it can alter the position of the mandible. So the patient, he should be completely relaxed. Then the next is the, if so the presence of any neuromuscular disease in the patient, it can influence the rest position. Fourth is the patient, they cannot maintain physiological rest position for indefinite time. So when you are taking this vertical dimension at rest, it should be quickly done. Next is the incorrect measurement. It can lead to faulty recording of the vertical dimension at occlusion. As we have seen, the vertical dimension at rest is a reference to the vertical dimension at occlusion. And if you are not taking the measurement correctly at rest, then it will lead to faulty recording of the vertical dimension at occlusion, and hence it can injure the supporting structures and the TMJ. Now, what are the methods of measuring the vertical dimension at rest? So these all are the methods of measuring it. So first is the facial measurement after swallowing and relaxing. So it is usually done with a vernier caliper. So this is the vernier caliper, and it is used in the measurement of the facial. So it is nothing but the, it is used in facial measurement. So the measurement, it is like the patient, he is asked to sit upright and relax. So first, two reference points, they are marked on the face, that is the tip of the nose and the tip of your chin. Then what you're doing is you're asking the patient to swallow, and after that you're asking them to relax, and after that you're just measuring the distance between these two reference points, and this is nothing but the facial measurement after swallowing and relax. The next is the tactile sensation. Now they, in this method, so the patient, it is, he's asked to stand erect and open his mouth wide till he feels discomfort in his muscles of mastication. Then the patient is asked to close his mouth slowly. Then the patient is instructed to stop closing when he feels that the muscles are totally relaxed, or it is, and they are so they are comfortable. The distance between the two reference points is recorded, and they are compared to the measurement which is recorded by the swallowing method. So this method, it relies on the patient's perception. So this can be like, it varies because it is totally dependent on the patient. The next is the measurement of the anatomic landmark. So the distance between the pupil of the eye and the rima oris, that is nothing but the corner of the mouth, and distance between the anterior nasal spine and the lower border of the mandible should be measured using a Wills guide. So this is nothing but the measurement of anatomic landmark. So this is A, when it is between the pupil of the eye and the rima oris. And next is the distance between the anterior nasal spine, and the last is the lower border of the mandible. So this distance is measured. If both these distances, they are equal, the jaws, it is considered at rest. Next is speech. So in this, there are two methods. In the first method, the patient is asked to pronounce a letter M, and after that, two, again you are marking 2 points, and then you are taking the measurement after you see the patient is completely relaxed. And in the second method, The dentist, they keep talking to the patient and he measures the distance between the reference point immediately after the patient, they stop talking. And this is the way that we are measuring usually in our colleges, that is the measurement of the vertical dimension at rest through this speech. When you ask the patient to like say some words or they are asked to pronounce some letters, and after the patient they ask to pronounce it, then after that you're measuring the distance between these two reference points after they are coming at rest. And the last is the facial expression. So the skin around the eyes and the chin, it should be relaxed. It should not be stretched. The nostrils, they are relaxed, and the breathing should be unobstructed. Then the upper and the lower lip, it should have a slight contact in a single plane. And this is nothing but the facial expression. When you see the facial expression is at rest, then you're measuring the distance of it. And this is all about measurement of the vertical dimension at rest. Now, vertical dimension at occlusion. So it is defined as, it is the length of the face when the teeth, they are in occlusion or they are in contact and the mandible is in the centric relation or the teeth are in centric relation. Now, what is the centric relation? I'm going to cover in the next topic, that is the horizontal relation. So in this, the vertical dimension is nothing but the length of the face when the teeth are in contact. So this is a constant point and it can be maintained for indefinite time. The methods of recording the vertical dimension at occlusions are, there are two, mechanical and physiological. So in mechanical, there is ridge relation in which there is distance from the incisive papilla to the mandibular incisor. Then there is parallelism of the ridges and there is pre-extraction record. That is nothing but the through profile photographs, radiographs, then articulated cast, facial measurements you are taking. So you're doing this measurement, that is the vertical dimension and occlusion. So now what is this ridge relation? In that, what you're doing is the positional relationship of the mandibular ridge to the maxillary ridge, it is measured. So it is the distance between the incisive papilla to the mandibular incisor. So in this, the incisive papilla, it is a stable landmark and that does not change. The next is the distance of the papilla to the mandibular incisal edge is usually 6 mm. So the distance between the incisive papilla and the maxillary incisor, that is the maxillary incisor edge, it is usually 6 mm. Then usually the vertical overlap between the upper and the lower incisor, it is 2 mm. As you know, the overbite is usually 2 mm. Hence, the distance between the incisive papilla and the lower incisor, it will be 4 mm. So based on this value, the vertical dimension at occlusion can be calculated. So this is nothing but the distance between the incisive papilla to the mandibular incisor. Now, what is parallelism of ridges? So the mandible, it is parallel to the maxilla only at occlusion. And this factor can be used to determine the vertical dimension at occlusion. The next is the pre-extraction record. So through pre-extraction record, so you're just measuring it, but now this becomes a limitation. If the patient, they don't have anything from this records, then you cannot measure the vertical dimension at occlusion through this records. Physiological method. In physiological method, you have PowerPoint. Then next is the using wax occlusal rim. Over here, this is the wax occlusal rim where you're just adding a triangular cross-section of modeling wax to the mandibular occlusal rim. Then there, next one is the physiological rest position. Now I'm going to explain because these two from the physiological, they are the most commonly asked SAQs and these are the methods which we are usually doing in our colleges. So the next one is the phonetic, aesthetic, swallowing threshold, tactile sense, and next is the patient's perception of comfort. Now what is this PowerPoint? It was given by Boss. So this is the method through which PowerPoint is done, but now usually it is not done. The next one is using a wax occlusal rim. The next is the important one, that is the physiological rest position. And this was given by Niswonger and Thompson in 1935. So physiological rest position, it was given by Niswonger and Thompson, and it is also called as Niswonger method. But it is not considered accurate because it depends on the patient's cooperation. And it can be variable and there can be alteration in the jaw position. So the procedure is the patient is asked to sit upright with his head unsupported and the eyes, they are looking straight. Then the upper and the lower rims, they are inserted and the patient is asked to swallow and relax. So when the relaxation is obvious, the lips, so after that you have seen the patient is completely relaxed. After that, what you're doing is you're just like parting the lip to reveal the space which is present between the occlusal rim. And this is called as freeway space. And I have said that if the patient is at rest, then you will see there is the presence of this freeway space. So the space which is present between the occlusal rim, it should be about 2 to 4 mm. The formula is VD at rest, that is vertical dimension at rest, is equal to vertical dimension at occlusion plus the freeway space. It can be used to evaluate the vertical dimension at occlusion. But now, if in this, the freeway space, you have calculated it. So what you're doing in this is, you're asking the patient to relax. After that, you're just moving that lips apart. So you're just moving the lips apart. And then you're just checking the freeway space. If you see the freeway space is more than 4 mm, then the vertical dimension at occlusion is considered to be small. And if the space is less, then the vertical dimension at occlusion, it may be considered great. So this is nothing but the Nisswangers and Thompson method of recording vertical dimension at occlusion. The next one is the... So now in phonetics, so there are two methods in which you can record vertical dimension at occlusion. So first is Silverman's closest speaking space, and the other is F or V and S speaking anterior tooth relation. So this is like a most commonly asked SAQ, that is the Silverman's closest speaking space. So it was first described by Silverman. According to him, the closest speaking space, it measures the vertical dimension when the mandible is in function. So when the sounds like CH, CH, S, J, they are pronounced, in that you'll see the upper and the lower teeth, they reach their closest relation, but they are not contacting. So this minimal amount of space which is present between the upper and the lower teeth, and this is known as Silverman's closest speaking space. Now, in ideal case, the lower incisor, it should almost touch the palatal surface of the upper incisor. So, if there is increase in the freeway space, it is indicating that there is inadequate vertical dimension occlusion. And if there is decrease in the space, it indicates that there is excessive vertical dimension at occlusion. And the contact of the incisal edge during speech, it also indicates that there is excessive vertical dimension at occlusion. Now, what is this F or V or S speaking anterior tooth relation? So, in this, what you're doing, you're just arranging the teeth, anterior teeth on your occlusal rim, and then you're seeing, then you ask the patient to pronounce words which are beginning with F, V. Then you are seeing the relation between them, and this is nothing but the F or V and S speaking anterior tooth relation. But this is not usually done, because in that you have to arrange the teeth, so it is not done. The next is the aesthetic. So aesthetic, it can be used to determine the correct vertical dimensions. This is done by selecting teeth of the same size as the natural teeth and by assessing the amount of residual ridge resorption. Next is the swallowing threshold. So it is considered that at the beginning of the swallowing, the teeth of the upper and the lower jaw, they almost come in contact. So this factor, it can be used as a guide to determine the vertical dimension at occlusion. And one more is the tactile sense. So here the patient's tactile sense or the sense for comfort, it is used to assess the vertical dimension at occlusion. So these all are the various methods, but the most commonly used method which we are doing is like through this phonetics only. But you are not arranging the teeth, you are just asking the patient to like say some words, and depending on that, you're measuring the vertical dimensions. And this was all about the vertical dimensions. Thank you so much.